Hello, everyone. Today's talk is titled Gaze of the Silent Polymath. And I don't want you to relate this idea to any person that you could potentially know, even me, but see it simply as an idea of what a silent polymath may look at. Now, a polymath is someone who is functional in many different branches of knowledge. And so if we are looking at the branches of knowledge and different applications of life, what is inspiring a polymath to be engaged in such multidimensionality of his own experience? Because back in the day, they weren't just one thing. Their knowledge, their degrees weren't specific like that, do you know? Right now, we're going to schools for certain specific degrees. Back then, the mind of Da Vinci would look at many realms of life and to see that the polymath was the cause of the knowing. So once you see that your knowing is not relevant to the structure of the game, the player that you become is never even able to win or lose. It simply becomes the whole movement. And so when you become the whole movement, your inspiration or your knowing or your engagement with life is at a moment where you are moving through your smooth flows of, I guess, result. So what that means is that many people are interested in the concept of intuition. However, instead of just seeing intuition, see that we don't want to call it names, we just want to see how the human being is evolving and transcending as consciousness, as awareness. So there is a requirement for self-awareness and self-knowing. And so you might have found it very impossible to put your hand on your own shoulder, but when you do that, you begin to see how that feels. You begin to see that self-communication is very intelligent once there is self-allowance. And self-allowance must be synonymous with existential allowance. Because if you are originating your creation as a limited idea, then your advancement has become less. We do not want to waste our sense of time and space, but be a very self-aware and conscious creator in our moment. And so it's both the awareness, the creation, and creator. And hopefully if we flip this coin, there may be a change in humanity. A change that knows itself so well that it straightens its jacket and walks to where it must. Once you really feel wisdom, you begin seeing that a part of you begins to appreciate the silence a bit more, because there are certain profound elements to exploring that which is unknown. If you constantly add the spices of mystery, excitement, and wonder to your life, and it's not something you add, you simply just become aware to what those mean to you and you align yourself to what it really means to you. And then function, you will see your functionality will be in many areas. So the silent polymath has his knowing before he steps into the noise. And so communicators recognize that the awareness to the communication is always beyond the communication. And so whatever world is created through terminology, ideology, and any form of translation, know that some aspects of a greater view are being reduced. And you don't reduce it for yourself. Have that knowing. Sometimes your intuition fades is because you are paying attention to realities where intuition is not possible. And so, regardless of how you're conditioned, it is up to you to practically experience yourself in more capable and able ways. I would like to share a quote by a very wise and compassionate human being and Sufi mystic. This poet says beautifully, silence is the language of God. All else is poor translation. And so many have come to this world to wonder what treasure it holds. But the treasure is actually beyond even a reality where man is looking at words too much. You will see how you are acknowledging yourself is so profound that you are your unique existential opening. You are the movement of the design of the cosmos now in where you're standing. And so man must really appreciate his body, his mind, and the higher state of collective awareness that composes all individuality to remember itself profoundly. There are moments in life I have personally walked through that I have seen their architecture probably as beautiful as the nicest arc that one can imagine. Now, in those moments, there were no words. And what that means is that I was a bit overwhelmed and hit by certain realities, certain things that suddenly happened, which I had no preparation for. And because I was not prepared, the way I was receiving that experience was emotionally disturbing me and also creating certain firm considerations that I was making about how I was doing in the environment. You care for yourself, and so if something is happening to you, an experience happens to you, you begin being concerned about your own concern. And in a sense, behave differently than when you have something, because certain things have taken away. And so, similar to how life may gracefully take our loved ones, life will also take, at certain times, based on certain experiences that you go through, certain ideologies away from you. You will see something that it will change your world. And here is where man begins to recognize that once he really can clearly see the beauty in a story through its transparency, then he has the ability to really appreciate the story. In other words, you cannot impose yourself only in one side of the spectrum and expect that in this growing life process that you are, you're not going to confront the other side. If you are still holding polarities to you and trying to say, this is what I want to see, this is what it is, if you're forcing reality upon your eyes, you will always know that that's not the real reality. And so every illusion also comes with a longing from beyond the illusion, which is really where you find yourself, to be a certainty outside of terminology, outside of terms and periods of spatial and timed shape. Shape is very significant right now to our technology, especially fractal and geometric shapes, because they're allowing man to see more naturally a certain plane. What that means is that now man is allowing himself more self-awareness, and through this self-awareness is also being given allowance to perceive in higher ways. So what is happening is actually we are going through a period as humanity and recognizing that this is our life, because we are here to pay attention to the things that are in front of us. If you have gone through anything, you were. This is when the seed sprouted. Regardless if you believe in the divine order of the light or the materiality of the soil, or the the evolution of the soil, regardless of what you believe or disbelieve. Man walks in more profound ways, and his terminology is limiting him. Terminology should become vehicles for civilization. It has not become a vehicle yet. It has become an illusion because man does not know how to utilize on subtler planes terms, sounds. We must allow our intelligence to naturally progress by not having our attention on realities where we are so certain in this infinitely changing cosmos that that is it. Do not give yourself certainty when you know that the unknown is an element that is beyond. So if you arrogantly consider certain abstracts to not be even potentially there, you have not just stabbed mystery in such a way where it might not come back, but you have given yourself a weight, and a weight that is heavy, but also one that you will see when you remember the mistakes that you have made and the moment before those mistakes were. That human being should not be forgotten. The kindness that you are made of before your act of criminality or criminal action, you must remember that, and you must work with that sense of self. Within your mind is a maze of beautiful, I guess, abstractions of form. What that means is I could look at a tree and in my mind it can get be architecture based on my whole ability to remember and recognize. This is your time here. How would your time be existentially memorable if you become the most profound, the most aligned, not to any shape which can suddenly create its own disorganization, but aligned to a knowing that you are here because you are here. And so when the meaning of life presents itself, once the meaningless of the personality that was held for too long has been seen, we never had swords trying to rip the veil apart. We were simply travelers that forgot our feet. But remember them, because you still have feet. I'm pretty sure I still have feet, even though my attention's somewhere else. So, know that it's very important for you to open doors in how you are looking at reality. What that means then is that if you look through the minds of the exceptionalist, you will see that he understands, he acknowledges the realness of the spectrum and the many different individual relationships that are creating a sense of collective. But he also recognizes that there are different states of being, and it's as if the X and Y axis were never enough when there was another dimension. So when you see that there are greater dimensions to man's mind, it is man's responsibility and the responsibility of smiling men who know they are able in every way, who are pilots of consciousness that navigate as instantly as how they breathe, then there will be moments where certain men have become the greatest treasure revealers of humanity. Become a treasure revealer of your being and just communicate the newest, most sincere and honest expression of your life. And do not, when fear comes to you, challenging you, when fear comes challenging you, do not attack. Do not take the same weapon as fear has. Because if you do, then you will be stuck in a realm where your weapon might not be enough. Do not acknowledge your fear as something that is in the present moment. Your fear has no allowance to be in your present moment where you have the gift of new experience. And as you push fear away, the voice of man has even echoed into the internal realms of abstract reality. Artists can now begin utilizing their intuitive ability by seeing that, all right, the human being, the ape evolves to the human being, but this being who's constantly evolving into greater forms, it's as if he has some amazing plans, and this divine attention that is the light that is pulling the seed into newer forms. We recognize that we are not like the tree because we are rooted in multidimensional soil. And what that means is that we should not be too keen on trying to cutting open the inconceivable, because there is a sharpness there that you will not pass due to how man's mind has accepted certain ideas to approach that idea even. Take a few steps back to see how they are always steps forward, because there are movement and progression in any observance. In other words, do not think that just because you don't know how good you are, that you are not good. Do not think you cannot do things that your inspirations are doing. Do not copy any life. Do not try to take others' imagery when you have the ability to create yours. Trust life and simply sit in that ride intuitively, knowingly, with the ability that regardless of what fluctuation of change happens, the light within your eyes, were the memories of starlight that could never be taken away. Man is opening up to his language in new ways. We must see the beauty. It's as if man has understood that his language was a source of his illusion. But wait a minute. Now that we've been in the illusion for a while, it's just not illusion. It's just like, just a certain form of reality. You know, and so when man is caught in his illusion, it's because he's planning on building something there. We are not caught in illusion, we're simply just planning to build amazing structures, amazing multidimensional presences here, energetic presences on our plane, and that is why we're getting a bit elusive in how we see things. In other words, man is young, but the wisdom of eternity is always there. Create your own ladder. Give it your own natural, beautiful design. Learn from the silent polymath who recognizes that in stillness, the greatest movements can be done. And so stillness of mind means no longer being in the dynamic or in the role of someone who's trying to be still or someone who is moving. You become the observance of your environment, and so your association with your body in a sense shifts in your subtler holographic visualization of reality. And so in that holographic sense, you will see that man's mind has always been multidimensional. It's just the way he's acknowledging it is limited. What that means is that we are given See it as this way. The bark, or let's say the trunk of a tree, is your physical life. It's your physicality. It's the thing that is orienting your sense of self and who you are really here, right? So your attention is on this physical thing more than anything. So at first your attention is on body, then it's on everyone else, you know, and then anybody else, you know. So once you become aware of this, you see that when man's self-awareness begins to rise based on, let's say, self-contemplation, self-awareness, and his mind begins to become more clear in its own reflection, let's say, you become more aware of what clarity is, and in a sense, you are being the expression, not trying to be clear, you know. Then you see man has also other subtler bodies. So the trunk then goes into different branches, and these branches branch out, you know. And so the way this tree is built is actually perhaps the way the cosmos is built. Because we are assuming linearity is the only way we can see. Because we are the people who are defining our world. And so if we choose to communicate in a certain intensity, that could limit the same truth in different intensities of communication. In other words, if I just come and say that the whole world, the laws of the universe are just based on my 5-year-old self, how that saw the world based on that knowing, and I don't ignore the fact, you know, I ignore the fact that they're different elevations and states of being and how now that age is different, then I am limiting my reality. Man needs holistic ways of really receiving his reality. In other words, science, many have said it's an underdeveloped science, but it is not. Science is a seed being planted right now, because once man begins becoming self-aware of his existential form, consciousness begins having more louder, bigger steps of expression, bigger leaps. And so you will see that the bigger leap of where you are directed is similar to how perhaps a quantum leap could be symbolized. You can see that your presence in your subtler realms are much different. And you will see the nature of how you're existing is different. So the way the trunk is at first, without having grown yet, you know, you see the trunk is just one way. It's just the bark, you know, it's just the wood. Then suddenly it changes to leaves and it's experiencing another form, you know? And after it experiences leaves, it experiences how fruits are made. And you see that it's as if the tree is so wise that it already knows how it's shaped, and silently it flows through the unshaped. You can see that you can always apply how you look at things to how everything else looks. In other words, vision can integrate. And when vision can integrate, you will see the voice of every great writer in humankind, the voice of every person who was alive was at inside within them, even though they didn't even say it. Do you know? Perhaps they never thought they could say it. But little did they know, some man would perhaps say words that would let their personality constructs rest, at least the amount that they're kept here. So you will see that the greatest writers and speakers, and anyone who has lived a life for others because he has recognized that self truly communicates another, in that existential compassion that is innately present on a subtler level of your knowing, you will want, as a communicator during your life period here, to give a beacon and to brighten up the good things from the past, and to carry, to bring a change of greater evolution, you know? And so, and I would like to share a quote by Pablo Picasso, actually, which I find really applicable to this talk. And he says, "Good artists copy, great artists steal." And I wondered what could that mean, because my involvement with art has been of a different kind, a different nature. However, I finally saw that the beauty in what he was saying is that don't just try to do what the other people around you who are great are doing. Don't try to copy, for example, Michael Jordan. But understand that if you could see through Michael Jordan's eyes, what would you then see would be a greater player? Do you know? So you see, because you cannot see that far, you need to begin you need to challenge yourself to expand yourself. Similar to how life here is telling us, you know you're going to die, but live on. You know, it's as if we're getting this push. We're getting this joyous movement with the wind. And in the context of someone who is a polymath and in their own silence is looking at different applications of their knowing to life, once the knowing is present everywhere, you simply just become a navigation of form. So you're no longer caught in an idea, you're actually a sense of very clear observance. And this clear observance is playful with thought. So in other words, thoughts do not have to mean anything. Words do not have to mean anything. Form can be empty. And in many cases, it is, unless the nature of the being wants to be more playful with the existential design of the projection of the hologram, in a sense, this holographic reality. And what that means is multidimensionality will open up to people more. You will see that great ideas were always inspiring action, and man has reached a point where words are useful but no longer here to carry the greatest torch. The greatest torch of contribution was the action of man to, with his core alignment of truth and honesty and sincerity, bring forth the work of the unknown. Man is very able, because his ability is beyond that. Simply the possibility of transcendence shows that our intelligence, regardless of how certain we become of how it works, is always shifting with everything else that is presently existent. Look in the eyes of those people who inspire you. And when I say look in their eyes, become just a compassionate view. Just become a transparent observance that if you could walk with Da Vinci, how would the gestures on his face look when he was thinking of the deepest question, perhaps? Be playful with your senses of self, your senses of reality, and anything which you are very, I'm going to say, mindfully from now on, looking at. And mindfulness means that do not clutter your mind by, once the mind gets cluttered, emotions begin to also get involved with it, and so certain reactions will come out of people. But don't clutter your mind. And recognize the reason is to be able to bring yourself back. For example, that's the reason why meditation has a certain significance, is because it aligns you with how your energies need to progress based on a program given from before, which is very interesting. It is perhaps the most interesting thing that there were some seers in the Upanishads. It is said, I believe, that the truth first came to the seers of thought. In other words, certain yogis, mystics, sadhus or siddhas, who in a sense we're landing some of the most important information into form. You will see that once your awareness is no longer individuated to just your body, that you are a collective awareness, you're not just a spatial collective awareness or one that is experiencing a different sense of time. You become a different sense of existential responsibility because your awareness to your environment is different. And what that means is that your sense of responsibility in one room is different in another room of existence. So for example here, my consciousness is responsible individually. So I carry on the concept of mindfulness and I work with a sense of gentleness. The Buddha said the intensity, the Buddha didn't say this specifically in the way I am saying it now, but he spoke of being so calm and peaceful that when you walk in this reality, it's as if you're carrying a flower. It is that gentle and peaceful how you're handling this physical reality. So for your physical range of acknowledging existence, see, you're acknowledging existence physically. When you're, for example, in a dream, that acknowledgement changes from physicality because you're having a more realer sense of your cellular realms of being. So carry the concept of mindfulness and begin working with yourself in ways where you're acknowledging different rooms of your presence, and also these rooms are not shaped, they're just feelings. They're just presence, it's very natural. These things are not things which you need to interpret to make it unnatural and then have senses of fear as if nature is not going to take you to the proper place. Nature is always dancing with you, and it is a very compassionate dance. Now, as we carry mindfulness, and there's a huge emphasis on this, into other realms, we see that the intensity of how we want to maintain the physical aspect of ourselves here is one where it is very gentle, as if we are holding a flower. The way we want to handle our subtler realms of thought, these subtler abstract realms where many people say astral projection or exterior views or whatever people like to call it, it's a very personal thing, so you don't need to really say it to others to have them agree with it or not. But regardless, man will begin seeing that the existential responsibility as a self-awareness presents him in a more liquefied form of reality rather than this physical solid one, then his responsibility in the physical also shifts a bit. In other words, if you are in a room and you see someone is shouting in the other room, you don't ignore it, you know there's something going on. You will naturally gravitate to go see what's going on. So we want to be aware of what's going on with us, but we want to acknowledge it properly and with mindfulness. And so consciousness technologies really become how thought is given a form from a consideration of a formed body, to then see that through emptiness the hologram was never here, only so that the realities that are present can be viewed in a very expansive way by any corner of spatial and timeful continuum. So you will see that after you have acknowledged your physicality and your body's calm and you're no longer that distracted by physicality, in other words, your shape has become a natural, beautiful, proper emanation. You're no longer trying to change things about your physical things, but you're allowing the change happen by becoming aware that a lot of physical change is still being steered by vehicles on our subtler levels of consideration and thought. And so, as we even surpass the structures of thought, the realms that open us to us are ones where our intuition through our own self-communication shall reveal to us. The treasure revealers of the future are also pilots and great explorers who will never find the treasure because they are it, but in a sense are also leaving behind the peaceful remnants of who they were and who they have now become in the omniscience of all. So, I like to think, and not even think, but even consider or look through the eyes of an engineer and the eyes of a designer. Because We right now are really like design. I mean, I like to get a new iPhone too. I like it. So what I like, it's good. But how I'm liking it, or the way that object or that function is coming to me, is also a bit dysfunctional. So it's not the most efficient way. We want our actions to be efficient. And then in the long run, we're like, wow, this is a very efficient way of living. And then we acknowledge the snapshot of our dream. That you have a snapshot of our dream, which is like, yeah, I want to go do this, you know? And you've had an experience which has given you a really strong feeling that you'd like to do that thing. But now, you need more than a snapshot. You need to, in a sense, go through the film. You need to be so active and engaged in your life that if someone asks you who you are, you silently smile, but everything that you have done also stands behind you. The great work appears when you begin to see the greatness in your being and how humanity's limitation never needed to distract the grace of eternal passage. For the limitless will, in a sense, compassionately provide you with the limitation, so a limitless, in a sense, ability to know alongside a greater resonance becomes more meaningful for you. So what that means is that you need to first look at the playground and recognize what a playground is, so that I can give you another different reality so you can consider. So if you suddenly see a lot of fluctuations in your reality, oh man, I just lost my job, oh man, this is changing, oh man, this is changing, that means life is saying, now's your time to stand. Now is the time where I am preparing you for the great things that you are about to do. And so you will embrace even the things that you find were the source of your misery. You will embrace everything that life is providing you in the moment to see that a pilot of consciousness always knew how to fly. And so the silent polymath is the greatest functionality of a being who's the observance of all dysfunctional forms. We are consciousness, and those words are silence. They dissolve into the silence and stillness of self-awareness and self-observance as you begin to acknowledge the collective view of your being rather than the individuated chain that you thought would never end. A very interesting story I want to share with you, and this story is very traditional. And I believe it's from Hinduism. And there was a sage. There was a very wise and enlightened being. And this enlightened man, he was an old man. I mean, he wasn't very old, but the way I'm giving it structure now to make it clear, visualize him as a rather man who is more mature. He's aging, for example. Now, this man is an enlightened being. So he has gotten the awareness of his natural expression and is the pure and complete allowance of it, so there's a sense of clear presence with him. So this sage is walking, and one day he's going to a new country, and he's just traveling, and he suddenly goes through a city where he sees there's a queen waiting for him in part of the forest, where the queen had heard the sage was coming. This enlightened master was coming. And so the sage, the woman, the queen is there, and the queen begins to talk to this guy, and so begins to get wisdom. And so the sage naturally just emanates his wisdom and talks. A spy finds out. The spy tells the king. The king becomes the worst nightmare of any tragedy we could consider. So what happens is the king finds out that the wife is with another man, and without even a consideration of who the man is, he says, execute him. And the way you're going to execute him is you're going to, in a sense, put his arms, tie his arms, and then cut bits of his limbs bit by bit every hour, right? And so many wondered, perhaps, from many views of life, why a compassionate being who had given himself to natural presence would fall this way. And so as this man was in his suffering, being given the last moments of his physical life, in a sense. He knew that there was nothing wrong. And so the way I'm going to extract the moral of the story here is that this enlightened guru didn't cry, didn't do anything, and comfortably, with the silence as if he had already stepped out of the situation, very playfully, left. And the whole point of the story was that later on, this sage evidently recognizes that it's based on some karmic function. It's based on something in the past in which this is happening. So the sage moves beyond karma by being comfortable with, the reality and how the life of forms is progressing. So in a sense, think of yourself as not being the awareness of the objects in the room, but the awareness of the room. So in other words, that spatial awareness can simply observe any form transitioning. So you are also that still and eternal moment that is untouched by any form. And as you become aware of this, there is no longer a karmic world, but you have stepped into a pure land where your eyes could never be closed. And so the silent polymath is always born through the inspiration of the moment. And all shall be done. With a smile that remembers itself. Much blessings and namaste.